back to your next guest lecture. My name is Llewellyn van Sail. I'm an assistant professor at the Eindhoven University of Technology, and I'm also an extraordinary professor with the Optentia Research Program. Today we're going to speak about something that I'm extremely passionate about, and that is all about strengths-based coaching. How do we utilize people's strengths in a one-on-one situation to help them to achieve their goals and to become the best possible version of themselves? This presentation is largely based on two studies that we've done, one systematic literature review on strengths-based coaching and the other one on coaching tools. So by the end of today, you should be able to have some framework to actually go out and physically coach someone and have some practical tools in your back pocket to help people to become the best possible versions of themselves. So what is strengths-based coaching? What are strengths? So I've spoken about this before, but just a little bit of a recap. As I mentioned, up until about 2000, the whole focus was really on understanding the negative stuff in people, right? Understanding what we call psychopathology, things that lead to poor performance and poor mental health, depression, anxiety, schizophrenia, dissociative personality disorder. That's more on the clinical side. On the organizational side, we really focused on things like poor psychomotor abilities for truck drivers. We looked at intelligence as a mechanism to predict performance. So we really focused on these negative orientated aspects. And we became really good at that. And we became really good at trying to fix the things that are wrong. So looking at things where people deviate from the norm and trying to get them from pathology, so not normal, to normal. And from this perspective, optimal functioning was defined by the lack of pathology. But we know that just because I don't have issues doesn't mean I'm living the best possible version of who I am. And by reinforcing in a coaching relationship, reinforcing these negative ideals, focusing on the negative stuff, really reinforces the low expectations that I already have about myself, about people, and about life. If I constantly talk about how negative stuff is, or it's just going to keep making me negative. So this is a downward spiral. If we keep talking about and focusing on the negative, you become dependent on the coach. You become dependent on external resources to make you feel better. Like I'm dependent on cake to make me feel better. Hence that I'm like 20 kilograms overweight now. And it discourages optimal development. So by just focusing on the negative, we really focus on trying to get people from not so good to normal, and therefore we disregard the optimal side of it. So we then moved away from this whole pathological idea to really understand optimal functioning and well-being. So away from Freud to the Seligman type of approach. And one way in which we can get people from to develop into the best possible version of themselves is through coaching. Okay. So what is coaching then? Coaching is really what we call a short to medium term professional relationship between an individual and a coach with a specific focus on helping a person to become a better version of themselves, to help them to enhance performance. The focus is really on, it's a very work-orientated approach. Of course, you get life coaching and you get performance coaching and you get all of these other types of things. But it really is the aim to help a person to become more efficient and more effective. The whole idea behind this is that we want to change people's behavior. And we do this by reframing the way in which they think about themselves and how they feel about situations. So finally, it's a really goal-orientated form of professional development. So it's very practical, it's very to the point. It's not like therapy where it's very esoteric. It's really goal-orientated. We break down, we figure out what your overall goal is. We break this down into smaller pieces and we help you to be able to take each step in order to be able to get there. So now your question is, but how is this different from psychotherapy? How is this different from counseling, mentoring, and training, right? So I want you to go and pause the video here and come up with two differences between coaching and counseling, coaching and therapy, coaching and training, and coaching and mentoring, right? These are the four things that are very closely associated with coaching. So pause the video here and come up with two differences on each one of them. What did you learn? Did you find something interesting? So I'm going to give you the answer in terms of this graph by Green and Palmer. They basically said that personal development, right, on an individual level is a function of two things. It is where the focus is. Are we trying to fix a problem or are we trying to generate solutions? Or am I telling a person to do something or am I facilitating a person to get there, right? So if we look at something like mentoring, for example, mentoring is a very positive orientated approach. It's unscripted, but it's basically an older person or a more experienced person telling you what will work, right? So it's basically, it's solution focused because it wants you, this person wants you to become the best possible version of yourself, but it's very instructive in nature, right? So it's helping you to generate solutions, but this person is sharing past experience, okay? So the main difference is that it's not a professional relationship. So it's not, it's an informal relationship between a person that is more experienced in a certain area or a lot older. The idea is that they kind of like help you to come up with solutions to your problems, but they tell you to do so in a very unscripted manner. In training or consulting for that matter, people get you in to fix a certain problem, to help you develop a skill or a capacity that you don't necessarily have. And it's a very passive process. So it's trying to fix, I don't know, presentation skills for that matter. And it's telling you, teaching you techniques on how to utilize it, right? So it's very generic in that sense. Therapy and counseling is very problem focused. So that therapy is trying to, more on the pathology side, so really trying to manage very deep psychological problems like depression, stress, and anxiety, where counseling is more about trying to solve life-orientated problems, like problems with my parents, problems with my friends, life-orientated issues. So here you come up with a specific problem, and you want to help you to get you through that problem. And it's a facilitative process. So not telling you what to do, but asking questions to help you to come up and generate your own solutions to your own problems. That is what the difference is between therapy, counseling, and coaching. Well, not the difference, but that's what that, for example, is. Coaching, on the other hand, is solutions orientated and it's facilitative. So it's trying to help you become the best possible version of you to kind of generate strategies and solutions and approaches to help you to get to where you want to go. And it's facilitative as well. So it's a professional relationship and the process is we're asking questions to help you again to come up with your own solutions to your own type of problems. So difference between mentor I spoke, between consulting and training we spoke, between counseling, mentoring and coaching. Coaching is more strengths orientated, more goal orientated, where therapy and counseling is more facilitative in that process. So it's very, very open-ended for that matter. Okay. Good? Excellent. So when do we use coaching then in relation to therapy and these types of things? So for example, we really use coaching when we want to, for example, want to develop leaders, right? Because coaching is also very expensive. It's not a cheap activity. So we really want to utilize it to help to get the most bang for our buck. And usually it's done all around leadership capability. We utilize it if you want to change behaviors in the short term. So therapy, for example, it's a long-term orientated approach trying to solve the underlying issues, because if we solve the underlying issues, we change our thoughts behind it. If we change our thoughts behind it, we change our behavior. Where coaching is very behavior orientated, we want to change behavior in the short term, right? We also want to utilize it for if we talk about a specialist, to help them to develop more technical capabilities and technical skills. It helps, for example, when we change job roles. So let's say, for example, you were a specialist now, and all of a sudden you're becoming a manager. So help you to transition between that two processes, because it's two totally different jobs. It also helps to help people to kind of mitigate the effect of major organizational change in uncertain times. So, for example, now during the COVID stuff, we can utilize coaching to help people to kind of transition from normal work to homework. And also, like I mentioned, to transition between promotions and these things. And then finally, it helps us to manage talent shortages, because you know, you're a 10-to-1, very highly efficient person, and you're not going to stay in your job for that long. So if we can develop people, there's this assumption in the management literature that basically say that You should have two backup people in your company to take over any role, right? So if a manager or someone highly efficient leaves, two other people need to be in place or need to be available to take over that person's job. So coaching helps us to get people ready to take over these types of approaches. But this is coaching in general. So what is strengths-based or positive coaching for that matter? So the first thing is that positive coaching is a paradigm, right? So there are various other paradigms out there. So system psychodynamics, behavioral models, there's all of these different approaches towards it, but they're paradigms. It provides us with a vocabulary to kind of understand and interpret behavior. Quick question. If we look about something like burnout, right? I'm going to give you four definitions and you tell me which one is right from four different approaches. So from the behavioral perspective, behavioral paradigm, burnout is nothing more than learned behavior. So you go through highly stressful scenarios and you learn how to cope with an ever-increasing level of workload. However, at one point, you're consciously you think you're able to cope, but physically you're not. Then you break. Okay, behaviorism. We've got system psychodynamics, which basically says that burnout is a function of an interaction between myself as an individual and the system, the company, and vice versa. So I project my stress and anxiety into the system, which in return makes the system anxious, and then it projects its anxiety and stress back onto me. What this means in practice is that I'm very stressed, then I go into a group meeting and I make everybody else stressed, they're stressed, and they come back to me with higher levels of stress, and then I'm stressed again, even further, right? That's system psychodynamics. Let's just use the last one. So the strengths-based approach basically said that burnout is a function of me not living in accordance with my strengths at work, which means that if I'm a highly creative person, but I am, I don't know, in an accounting job, I can't utilize my my creativity, I'm going to burn out because there's a disassociation between the person that I am and the job that I do. Which one of these three is right and which one of these three is wrong? If you said that all three is right, you are right. Because the paradigm helps us just to interpret the behavior and it gives us a means to address a specific problem. So here it provides us with this vocabulary and this interpretation framework. Because of this, it helps also to direct our coaching intervention in the appropriate ways, where the behavioral person would focus on really changing the behavior-orientated stuff to unlearn the learned behavior, where the strengths guy would help you to match your strengths a lot more towards your work. Like I also mentioned, it provides a framework for understanding and predicting and managing the coaching process. So it helps us to get from the first coaching session to the end in a very structured manner. But really important here is that there are a lot of coaching paradigms out there, a lot. And you have to find the paradigm that really suits you, that really fits you. The positive approach really fits me because I'm naturally inclined to look for the good in people. It's always been there with me. So the positive approach really talks to me. However, the psychodynamic approach, where I really have to go look at the negative and the anxiety and the conflict and the identity issues, that approach doesn't work for me. Although it's an excellent paradigm, but for me personally, it doesn't work. So you have to find also the paradigm that works for you to be more efficient. So from our study, we basically found that, positive coaching, again, it's also a short to medium term collaborative relationship between a coach and a client. The aim is really to help develop personal strengths and how to utilize them a lot more. The focus then is to utilize these strengths to help enhance positive stuff, so positive states, traits, and behaviors. And we do this through a process called Socratic goal setting. So we utilize our strengths to help us to set goals and utilize these goals, our strengths to be able to get us to our goals. And we utilize evidence-based approaches, so things that's worked in the past. The specific focus here is to facilitate personal growth to help us to become the best possible version of ourselves. We don't necessarily want to manage negative behaviors, for that matter. We want to optimize them. So how do we utilize our strengths to become better? And then, like I mentioned, help us to actualize a person's potential. So basically, positive coaching is all centered around a professional relationship between you and a coach, where the coach helps you to identify what your strengths are, how to utilize your strengths to set very specific goals for yourself, and how do we utilize those steps to be able to achieve the goals that we've set out for ourselves. And it's all centered around developing positive stuff and not necessarily developing negative things. So we've come up with this model. This is a model that we published recently that we call the Positive Psychological Coaching Framework. And we basically say that positive coaching is a chronological process of five phases that is supported by three continuous processes. And I'll go through all of these things in a lot more detail. But the first phase is we have to establish a mutually beneficial relationship with people. And here the focus is really on establishing rapport, understanding what the environment of the client is like, understanding what their needs and their goals are. So the first phase is really important because this basically dictates the rest of the process. So establishing a positive relationship. The second phase is where we go and we assess people's strengths. So really, we call it strengths-based profiling feedback. We do a bunch of psychological assessments, whether it's strengths assessments, personality, values, and etc. And we give a person feedback so that they know what their strengths are, because a person needs to become consciously aware of what their strengths are so they can utilize them a lot more. We know what strengths are, but we don't have the vocabulary. And because we don't have the vocabulary for it, we don't utilize them. And that's unfortunately then the negative cycle. Once we've given people their feedback on their strengths and they know what they are, we help them to create the perfect version of themselves, right? So we ask them to come up with an ideal vision of themselves, the best possible version, and we then try and figure out what the elements of this are. So that in the fourth phase, we can break down that ideal vision into very concrete steps, short, medium, and long term, and come up with strategies in order to help them to get to that point. And in this phase, we also facilitate that process. So this is not just a once-off thing, this is a continuous process where we help them with this process and we track it to the effectiveness over time. The last phase is when we conclude our relationship. So this is where we have to prepare the client for the termination of the, like we've achieved all of our goals or the contract has run out. So we either finish the relationship or we start recontracting. So we look at, oh, did the coaching process work or not? And then we start all over again. Okay. So these five steps or these five phases are supported by three continuous processes. So the first one is empowerment. And this process is really helping a client to reframe negative things from a positive perspective. And here we try to empower or reinforce positive behaviors and help break down negative type of experiences. So the coach's thing here is to try and help a person to say, oh, you utilize your strength there, and make them more aware of their strengths process, but also help them to change their mindset from a victim to a survivor, for example. So this is where the coach's micro skills and things come into play. Each phase is then also supported by what we call with learning transfer. So here we have, after every coaching session, we would give homework, for lack of a better word. That is evidence-based, so it's things that are validated techniques and tools that's worked in the past, where a person can take the learnings from the coaching session and go and apply them in the real world. Things like a gratitude visit or something like that. So it's a technique that after a session, based on the learning of that specific session, where they can go out and action this a lot more. And then finally, the last continuous process is what we call action tracking and continuous evaluation. So unlike therapy and these types of and training, we really want to make sure that our process that we've implemented with a client is working the way in which we want it to. So we implement certain things where we can evaluate and track the effectiveness of our intervention, of our coaching process throughout the entire process, the relationship. I will show you how to do this in the past. So it's really important to have measures, both quantitative and qualitative stuff in place that show you that your process is actually working. Okay, so the first phase. So if you talk about the first phase, creating the relationship, it's really important that we clarify expectations with all stakeholders and not just our client. We have to understand what the senior, so we always go with like two levels up in the organization, and we really want to understand what senior management's view for the role is, also for you as a person, The same with your direct line manager. So we try to clarify what are their expectations of you, what are the expectations of the role, where do they see this role going in the future, what's the function of this role, so that we are very clear, have a very clear mindset of the client's basic environment. We also want to clarify the expectations between the client and the direct manager. And we use something like what we call psychological contract formation. So we say, Mr. Line Manager, what do you expect of Mr. Client? And Mr. Client, what do you expect of Mr. Line Manager? And both of you, what do you expect of this role? So therefore, it becomes very tangible and concrete what they both want from this role, because we also help develop these people based on the capabilities of that role. And then finally there, we also clarify expectations directly with the client. So what do you expect of me, client? And what can I expect of you? And what do you want from this coaching relationship? So that we are very clear what we want to get out of this. We have to also, the second point is we also have to get to know the client's environment. We have to understand how this client works, how he functions, what his role is. And we do this through various ways. We can interview the management, we can job shadow them, follow them around for a day, see what their tasks involve, how they interact with people. We can look at documents and emails that they've written. We can look at past performance appraisals. So we can really understand, we really want to understand the nature of the job, because we always develop a person in role, in job. With this, in the job stuff is done. As a coach, you have to establish an open and trusting relationship with your client. And you have to create an environment where the client feels they can share things with you without the fear of being judged. So creating a non-judgmental environment. And really important here is that you have to establish rapport with the person, because this phase, the relationship, is what dictates the success of the process. If you don't click with a person, the effectiveness of the intervention, of the coaching process, is really not going to work. So here are some techniques, practical tools that you can utilize. For example, how to establish rapport. You can use the ARTS process. Ask questions, then listen, respond with empathy, teach your own perspective, and share decision-making process, right? SOLAR is a way to, it's what we call micro skills. It's help to establish relationships. So always sit squarely in front of a person, have an open posture, lean a little bit forward when the person is talking, try and maintain eye contact, and have a relaxed pose. Psychological contract we just spoke about, showing curiosity, showing genuine interest in people, and utilize other micro skills like attending, questioning, paraphrasing, and these types of aspects. So important again, questioning is the fundamental principle of coaching. So really try and learn how to do strengths-based interviewing, for example, how to ask strengths-oriented questions so that you can really solicit the positive things in people. Okay, second phase is all about strengths profiling. Now here, the purpose of this phase is really to explicitly identify the strengths in people. So we really want to go out and help them identify what their strengths are, both in a quantitative and qualitative manner. So through stories that they're telling, as well as through psychometric instruments that we have. So we want to get a full overview of a person. So we usually assess a person against some other capability framework, which involves strengths, of course, but also certain competencies, values, experiences, and etc. But we have to assess them against all of these things so we have a holistic picture of the client. The focus here is to understand, of course, the client's strengths, but also his perceptions of his strengths. So how does he define creativity, if creativity is one of his strengths? Because we have to use this again later to try and reinforce that type of behavior. People in this phase, we really want to also shift the mindset away from having this negative orientated approach. So I want to fix this, I want to build better, I don't have a good relation with my boss, I want to fix that. I'm not so good with this, I'm not so good with that. We want to change that mindset. This over-obsession with weaknesses will eventually make you depressed and negative and burnt out. And we want this process also there to help us identify potential external resources and personal resources. So things inside of you that you can use that buffer against this high amount of job demands that you, for example, have on your mental health and performance. So there are some techniques that you can utilize to do this. I mentioned this in another video. So we've got strengths-based interviewing. You can focus on what a person likes doing, for example, strength spotting, asking a client to tell a story and then where he was at his best, and really try and listen for the strengths. There are a bunch of psychometric tools that you can use, positive 360s, VI strengths, some positive projection techniques, the Realize 2. There's a whole bunch of them out there. Just make sure that they're validated. Personality assessments, which is also important. I like to utilize the Myers-Briggs type indicator because it gives a nice framework that people can listen to. A friend of mine always made the joke and said the MBTI is basically like giving a person their user's manual that they're supposed to get at birth. Then I also assess 16 factor personality index that helps us just to get a more in-depth view of underlying things. And I use life satisfaction, and I'll show this to you in three slides from now, but I always measure life satisfaction, which is happiness basically, overall. In life, and I track this every week or every month with a person. It's just 5 items, and that helps me to track the effectiveness of the coaching process based on how happy they are. We also use competency-based assessments. Like I mentioned, we have a capability matrix with certain capacities that we want to assess, and we utilize various techniques. So we can use simulations or job shadowing to kind of assess them, and guided self-reflections, asking people to tell stories where they were at their best. My icons are gone. The third phase is then, now that we know what the strengths are and the client knows what his strengths are, we ask them to come up with an ideal or the perfect version of themselves. Here we want to try and help them to move away from that mindset about what we should do versus what we want to do. I should be more efficient at work. I should function a lot better. I should do this. I should do that. If I focus on what I should do, I'm going to be negative because I'm correcting what is wrong. But if I focus on what I want to be a good professor, I want to be a good lecturer, I want to be a good online teacher and a coach. If I focus on what I want to do, I'm also a lot more committed to it. So I have to change that want, that should to want behaviors. There's a nice technique that I like to use called the 3 Whys. It comes from Crucial Conversations and job crafting, where you ask a person 3 times why something is important. So if there's something you ask a person, what is negative in your work, for example? So let's say admin. I really don't like admin. But why don't I like admin? Why is it bad? Well, it takes a lot of time. Why is taking a lot of time an issue for you? Well, because I don't really have it, like I've got so much work to do. Why do you have so much work to do? Because I take on too much. So the issue is not the admin. The issue is that you've got, that you personally take on too many roles and tasks, and then you don't have time to do the things that you do. A very good technique. We also focus here on push factors rather than pull factors. We focus on pull factors rather than push factors. Push factors are things that pushes you away from things. Pull factors are things that draw you towards it. If I want to run away from things, right, the issue is always going to be there. But if I want to change something, if I'm going there because something is better or more amazing, I'm going to be a lot more committed. And in this phase, if we know what the ideal vision is, we ask the person to create the perfect version of themselves by telling a story from themselves 20 years in the future. We ensure that there is alignment between this vision that the person has, between their values, their goals, and their capabilities, to ensure that there is an accurate reflection. So a nice technique that we can utilize, for example, is the SOAR framework. I like this framework a lot. It's kind of the same as a SWOT analysis, but on an individual process, where we focus on what's your strengths, your opportunities, your aspirations, and what are the results that you want to achieve. This is the framework that I use to help a person to come up with that best version of themselves. And you can ask some questions there, for example. So in this future version of themselves, what are your greatest strengths? What were some of your best opportunities? Or what are some of your best opportunities? What is your aspirations in terms of this? And how will we know you've achieved it with results? Some practical tools that you can use. You can use appreciative inquiry and SOAR to help you come up with this process. So discovery, figuring out what already works well in your life, dream, what is the best possible version, design, coming up with ways in which to kind of bridge the gap between where you are now and your dream, and destiny, kind of implementing process to achieve it. Okay, the fourth phase is goal setting, and this you should be very familiar with already. So now we utilize our strengths to help us to figure, to break down that ideal vision into very tangible orientated goals. From these goals, we help a client to develop strategies centered around their strengths. So if I use my strengths to get to my goals, I'm a lot more committed. And then we figure out a way to implement it or execute the process. So for goal setting, for example, we figure out what we call a gap analysis. I mentioned this a couple of seconds ago. We look at the ideal vision and we look at current reality and we figure out how big that gap is, so that we know how far a person needs to change, or how big it is, the change that needs to take place for him to be able to get there. And it also, it's important to ensure that this person also have realistic expectations here. We utilize SMART goals, smarter goals, to help us to break down that ideal vision into tangible, actionable steps. And we figure out how do we utilize our strengths in each one of these aspects to be able to get us there. We need to come up with a way to balance the challenges that the person has with their skills and strengths. If the challenge that I'm facing is way above my skill level and my strength capability, then I'm not going to be able to achieve it. And if I don't achieve it, I'm going to be a lot more negative. So the challenge needs to be just a little bit higher than your current skill set in order to be able to push you to learn new things. But if it's too high, I learn a lot and I'm going to fall down because I won't be able to ever get there. So it needs to be realistic and just slightly above a person's current skill set. We have to ensure that the goals, again, is highly congruent with their strengths. So if a goal is not aligned to their strengths, so for example, if you are an extreme introvert but you want to become the best public speaker on earth, the alignment, but you don't have, for example, public speaking or whatever as a strength, then it's going to become very difficult for you. But we can utilize other strengths to kind of help you with that. So how do we utilize these strengths then? And the last part is then Socratic goal elimination. So here the idea is to say to break this, take these goals and figuring out which is the noise goals and canceling those ones out and figuring out which goals I need to focus on first in order to be able to get me there. Think about playing the piano. You want to become a concert pianist, right? You're not going to first start by learning Beethoven's concerto. No, you're going to start with the basics. How to read the keys, how to read notes, for example. You have to start with the basics before you can actually get up to the major ones. So learn the important skills first. Once we have this in place, we have to develop a strategy. So we call this we have to take this goals that we have and also align them in such a way that the steps that we need to take actually capitalize or build on the previous things that we've achieved. So we have to develop an operational goal strategy to take our ideal vision and make it into actionable steps. Also mentioned, make sure that these goals are then, each goal is also broken down into tangible steps with clear specific deadlines so that you know exactly when to go, where to go, how to go about getting them. We also have to look at external resources that people have and the specific strengths a person needs to achieve a specific goal. An important thing that we do not necessarily take into consideration is looking for our blind spots. So there are things that I know about me that you don't know. There are things that you know about me that I don't know. And those blind spots are the things that I need to figure out. And because these are the things that will kind of like hinder our goal processes. Very important, find your cheerleaders. You really need a lot of people to kind of support you. That it doesn't matter how stupid your idea is, that there are willing to take you forward, that support you, that will cheer you on, that will make you empowered, because you need this at least in the beginning of the process in order to help you to at least learn the skills that you need a lot more faster. Also make sure that you have assigned clear deadlines to each one of the goals and ensure that there is accountability to each one. And we do all of this by formulating an individual development plan or a personal development plan. Here we capture all of the strategies, all of the processes, all of the goals that we have in a plan so that a person knows when, what it is that we need to achieve, what are the behaviors I need to action, when can we figure out who do I need to help to get me there, when can we evaluate if it has been achieved. So set this all in a plan. And then finally, implementation. And like my supervising psychologist always said, it's just do it, right? There's no how or low. It's just taking the plan and start actioning it. But it's also important to both give your client very clear and immediate feedback, but also ask him to get feedback from his peers and his manager. Because we need immediate feedback so that people can change appropriately. And we need to figure out a way to give them real-time updates on their goal progress, for them to give you real-time updates. So I utilize a certain application that we've developed that a person can update so that I also know where they are at. And there are certain strategies that you can use. Like I said, we use smarter goals, set specific, measurable, attainable, realistic, and time-bound goals, but they are also evaluative, and we can readjust them if things don't go very well. There's also this Casio brainstorming technique to help a person set specific goals. We look at the circumstances. What circumstances do I need to change? What attitudes do I need to change? What standards and goals am I setting? Because sometimes I have very high expectations for myself. And what are the most important priorities that I need to focus on? And finally, what are other domains that I can focus on that help me to grow and develop? And finally, and this is something you're going to do as an activity, there's a nice technique called the Wheel of Life domain, where you list 10 domains that are important for you, so family, relationships, works, etc. You get the client to rate them on a scale of 1 to 10, 1 meaning I don't have it at all, and 10 it's the perfect world. Then you have to ask the client to describe, he needs to describe to you what a 10 would look like in that specific phase. And that means taking out all constraints. So if money was not an issue, if time was not an issue, what would a 10 look like there? And then you ask them to rate themselves on a scale of 1 to 10, their definition, and then focusing on the two or three things that are the lowest. And I'll explain this to you later. Okay. So the homework or the learning transfer, so each one of these phases kind of like build into this, and we have to take in each one of these phases or each one of these processes, we have to teach people new skills, right? So we have to change the way in which they think about something, but they also have to go practice this in a real world scenario, not just with you in the coaching session. So we utilize some techniques that have already been developed, and I'll show you that in a minute, that they can action to go practice the things that you've taught them. Like I mentioned, it needs to be evidence-based practices, so it needs to be things that's already been developed, that's shown that it works. And the process here is to develop actual practical skills. So, and we do this through a process called deliberate practice. Now, deliberate practice means that I break down a specific skill into very small tasks, so I focus on the right things first, and then I focus on the things that I'm not so good at, and I try to improve those aspects through utilizing my strengths a lot more. So here are some things that have shown to work in the past. Going for gratitude visit, writing gratitude letters, affirming your positive values, writing a positive life summary, giving a client a positive book to read, generating a favor bank. This is a nice one. Every time you do something for someone, you basically buy credit with them. So every time you do something for them, you're actually buying social capital. So doing a lot more things for people will, I call it a favor bank, will create the reciprocity later. Savoring your life tasks, etc. and etc. So these are some techniques that you can utilize to help you with that process. So another continuous process, empowerment. Here we want to help a person to connect himself to the bigger picture, right? So we know life is objectively meaningless, right? But we want to help them to create meaning themselves. We want them to understand what is meaningful to them and helping to align their lives to this overall arching goal. The coach is important because we reaffirm a client's confidence in their own capabilities. So every time they would action a strength, we say, oh wow, I can't believe you used gratitude there. So we really want to help them and empower them to become more aware of their strengths, and even when they are using them. It's also important here, the purpose of this is also to help a client to get more control over regulating daily tasks and their daily lives, so self-determination. And we really want to make a client feel like they're making a difference in their work and in their job. So that's the purpose of empowerment. The way in which we do this is we role model behavior, so we act because they learn from you. We try to highlight positive things, always trying the positive narrative, keeping the positive narrative there. We always focus on what's right and not what's wrong. So if they say, oh, I had a massive conflict with this person and I had to go talk to them, it's like, oh, wow. So you actually went out and spoke to this person? How brave of you. Trying to bring the thing back to their strengths. We want to reframe the victim to survivor mentality. This is important part of the strengths-based framework. Because people tell stories from a victim perspective, right? But we can ask them to tell the same story, but as a survivor. This came from back in the day when they did stuff with rape victims, and they asked them, like, after 10 years or so, once they've gone through it, so tell your story, like, how did you get through this? I mean, it must have been so traumatic. And then they tell their story, like, as a survivor, and this has a major impact on their well-being. We always frame questions in a positive way. We can ask, for example, what's wrong in your company, right? And they'll list all the things that's wrong. But I can get the same information by saying, what's important for you in your company? It's exactly the same information, but you frame the question differently, and therefore they also already interpret it differently. The question in itself is already an intervention. Like I said, also reframing failures as opportunities to learn. Finding 15 things about... Oh, I like this one. So this is a technique that someone developed a couple of years ago, and they started off by saying, look at someone in your life that has really hurt you, right? And try and figure out 15 things that make that person positive. So really forcing you in a very negative situation, negative bad person, to find 15 positive things. Think about someone like Donald Trump, right? Find 15 positive things about Donald Trump, right? It's really difficult, but if you can teach yourself, you can find negative, positive things in negative people or negative scenarios, you've really mastered this. And then finally, we celebrate the successes with our client. Almost done. The last action tracking part is active action tracking and evaluation. The purpose here is to make sure that we are actively tracking the progress of the client and ensuring that they are on track. So this is the measure how we define what success would be. So in the beginning, we say these are the expectations and how we define what success is. And here we break it down in ways in which we can measure it. So then we measure success over time. We have to develop some other action tracking or goal tracking process. This can be through the personal development plan or some other qualitative process where you can spend the first 5 minutes of each coaching session talking about the goals that you've the person has achieved before. Like I said, we have to measure both two things, both the goals the person may achieve, but also well-being on a monthly basis. Why? Because it doesn't matter if I achieve all my goals, but if I'm unhappy, it also doesn't work. So like I mentioned before, I use like the life satisfaction inventory, and I track that over time, because overall happiness is an indication of my process working. And then finally, like I said, your IDP, your personal development plan, is the Bible for the developmental process. That thing becomes like the script that you're reading off of to ensure that the person is achieving what he needs to achieve. Oh, shoot. The final phase is then, the final process is then concluding the relationship. So usually about two sessions before the coaching process is going to end, I prepare my client by saying, oh, we're almost done, you've made such good progress, maybe two more sessions. So you have to really prepare them. You can't just end the relationship there. So you have to prepare them for termination or recontracting. So if you still feel that there's, if he still feels or she still feels there's a need to continue, then you recontract and you start the process over again, where you reformulate expectations and blah, blah, blah. You measure the success. We also want to give them and the people that are paying you, the company, feedback in relation to the coach's process. So here we do the assessments that we did in the beginning again, so we can track development, but we also can utilize 360 evaluations and other types of techniques. But it's important to give the client and the people that are paying you, the organization, feedback on the client's development. And then finally, if you find that you need to recontract, then we start with re-clarifying the expectations with these stakeholders and the client. Okay, as an activity, on your workbook, there is this life wheel that I've created, and I've just thought about 10 things that might be important for you. I want you to do this with a friend, right? So two together. So firstly, you're going to ask your friend to reflect on a moment on each one of these life domains, right? So just what does this mean for each one of you? How you define romance, how you define friends, and etc. Then come up with an idea of what a perfect would look like, a 10 in that scenario, given that money and time is not an issue. Then I want you to rate yourself on a scale of 1 to 10 on each one of these aspects. And then draw a line. So if I have an 8 on business, a 6 on finances, a 10 on family, a 2 on health, I want you to draw a line between each one of these points, because we, in effect, we want a balance. We want a nice round wheel, because that's how, you know, a car drives. It can't drive on a crooked wheel. Then looking at the areas that's super crooked, the ones that are super low, I want you to then, your friend and you, to help you to reflect upon how can we get that low aspect, so let's have a 4 on personal growth, how can I get that to at least a 6? Right, so brainstorm 5 ideas on how to get there. Make sense? Good. Ladies and gentlemen, that is then it for this guest lecture. I really hope that you learned something from positive coaching, and that you will be able to apply it in your real life. So thank you guys very much for your time, and if you need anything, just let me know. Have a great day.